Good morning, everyone. It's really good morning, early session, to keep us in the right pace for the meetings during the day. So we are here today to talk about digital transformation and bridging the digital divide. We have a large set of interveners, but I will start to give the floor to the Deputy Director of the BDT to address the opening remarks. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. It's a practice to start a little bit early and finish 12 o'clock. It's a practice of IT. And thank you. Thank you very much for coming. Excellencies and distinguished guests, distinguished panelists, ladies and gentlemen, it's my great pleasure to join you this breakfast meeting, or early morning meeting, Digital Economy, Accelerating Digital Transformation Through Innovation. ITU, in particular Telecommunication Development Bureau, has working closely with partners here and member states to bring together technology and innovation to create synergies which will take us further and faster towards achieving sustainable development goals. Especially SDG 9, build resilient infrastructure, promote inclusive and sustainable industrialization, and foster innovation. That is one of the key SDG. Innovation plays a major role in global development agenda by enabling digital transformation and creating new and improved services for citizens, bringing multiple stakeholders and sectors together to strengthen innovation ecosystem is essential to unlock opportunities and ensuring sustainability. We believe that shaping and developing national ICT-centric innovation ecosystem is critical in accelerating development and fostering digital economies. Additionally, fostering and connecting innovation ecosystem is essential to accelerate the development of ICT-enabled industries and sustainable digital employment. ITU has worked together with other international organizations, including WHO, UNESCO, FAO, and others, global experts and key stakeholders to shape its innovation agenda with aim to accelerate digital transformation. ITU innovation research has shown that there is a growing digital innovation divide. Our ultimate goal is that BDT to help close this innovation divide. As you may know, Europe is a front runner among us, has regional initiative on innovation, which was adopted at previous World Telecommunication Development Conference 2014. As part of this regional initiative, we concluded many initiatives, activities in Europe, including first country review on innovation ecosystem in Albania. In addition, BDT has been actively implementing activities all over the world, including Argentina, Kenya, Moldova, Rwanda, and Thailand. And we have recently finished a country case study on Rwanda, Moldova, and others. ITU's innovation services and toolkit provides roadmaps, frameworks, and flagship project for countries' journey towards digital economy. It engages key stakeholders and fosters innovation systems at country level to ensure that analysis and policy guidance reflect the realities of countries and fit their needs, and that flagship projects are sustainable and holistic in addressing their challenges. I am pleased to inform you that we have recently launched toolkit for strengthening ICT-centric ecosystem, which will be empowering countries to accelerate their digital transformation through innovation. ITU innovation research has also shown that resources are urgently needed to help foster and catalyze dynamic ICT ecosystems that can ensure sustainable development of digital economies. Without targeted resources, to build innovation capacities, countries are unable to develop an enabling environment that allows accelerated public service transformation. Entrepreneurs cannot address social needs with innovation solutions. And SMEs are unable to grow and create sustainable employment for their communities. Additionally, without unified common agenda in the national and international community, existing resources already invested are seen ineffective and deepening sustainable issues. I would like to invite you today to actively participate in this unique event and share knowledge on innovation, a topic that is critical to the development. We hope that this event will inspire you and empower you to get more involved in the digital transformation journey in your own country and contribute to the ITUD mission to foster ICT for development. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Yushi. So with no further delays, we have a large number of panelists. I'll briefly introduce all of them. We have Mr. Alberto Patron from CESI, Argentina. We have Ms. Nibal Idlebi from UNESCO. We have Dr. Ismail Shah from PTA Pakistan. Mr. Ricardo Perez from the Ministry of Modernization. We also have Sergei from the Moldovan Republic. We have Mr. Ba, our innovative guru from the BDT, and myself, Felipe Batista from Martel, will be the moderator for today. So, with no further delay, this is a very important panel because we've been discussing this along the way, also on the sidelines of the WTDC, because innovation is really the key factor to modernization and also to bridge the digital innovation divide that is growing faster and faster every day, and it's very important that the ITU and all the people involved in this work take good care of this issue in order to anticipate future problems that afterwards will be hard to tackle. So for today's objectives of this panel, I hope we can manage. We'd like to understand innovation, the innovation ecosystems, and the digital innovation divide. We also try to build an understanding of the challenges and opportunities to accelerate digital transformation and achievements. We also will try to understand the digital innovation frameworks that are needed to accelerate the digital transformation. And last but not least, we'll try to discuss on the resources for accelerating digital innovation divide. That's one of the key factors that we are here today to address. So I'll start with Ms. Nibal from UNESCO. I'll address you a question. There is a lack of common language about innovation and innovation ecosystems in fostering sustainable development. What is innovation, and how can innovation accelerate and foster sustainable development with innovation? Thank you very much.
Good morning, everybody, and thank you for including ESCOA in this panel. In fact, innovation, it is a very buzzy word, and it is used in different terms, and it is used in different contexts, and in each context, we can see that it has different meaning. However, the most common definition, let us say, of innovation, it is the one that was defined in 2005 by OECD, and it is included in the Oslo Manual, and which say that innovation is the implementation of a new or significantly improved product or services, and also it could be the new methodology of work, a new method for marketing, a new method for the organizational process within an organization, or even a new process for interacting with external relations. And this is maybe the most comprehensive definition of the implementation. It's been a new and or significantly improved product or services. Then this is maybe the most significant, but also, I mean, I would like to say that there is a very good linkage in general between innovation and research and development from one side, and there is also linkage between innovation and technology from the other side. If we take a look on the technology, we can see that innovation, in fact, it has improved dramatically the technological scope, and it enhanced technology in a very rapid way worldwide, and it enables the production of new medium devices and services. But in the same time, innovation today, technology enables innovation, and it is the driver of innovation. If we look at least at the mobile devices, and we can see the smartphone, how much it enables the advancement of innovation. It is really a platform for innovation. Then this is a very important linkage, and also the linkage with research and development, because in general innovation, it is especially for the in developed world, I mean, we can say that the innovation results from extensive research and development in either in the firms or in the academia or a joint effort between academia and firms. Then these are the linkage, and this is the context in which we are thinking about innovation. However, today we can think also about innovation from the grassroots, I mean innovation from individual, which are not necessarily resulted from R&D, and this is very important for developing countries, I would say. Just to finish with this, I mean, sometimes new, when we speak about new, it is new in the context. It is not necessarily new in the absolute terms, in the world at global level, but it could be new in the context, in the local market, at national level, then it's new in terms of to the new market. This is what is also important very much for the developing country, that they can contribute to innovation even if they are not really very extensive, they don't have a lot of efforts in the R&D.
Thank you very much, very clear. Another issue is regarding the ecosystems. There are several ecosystems around this innovation buzz that's going around in our world today. And one, for sure, the most important one should be the entrepreneurial ecosystem. I would like to hear from Mr. Ricardo Perez, from the Minister of Modernization, what are your country's strategy in terms of empowering this entrepreneurial ecosystem, and then followed by Mr. Alberto Patron, so we'll have the two views from the public and from the private sector. Please, Mr. Ricardo.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Before to start, I would like to say I'm sorry because I don't have a good English, so I will try to speak better than I can. I would like to talk about what are we working from the ICT Secretariat to improve the development of an entrepreneur ecosystem. We consider that the ICTs are absolutely necessary for development goals. Innovation and data are important themes in the entire agenda as a vehicle to achieve all the sustainable development goals. The thing is, how new data and real-time information system can improve decision-making process. For the digital transformation of a country, the role of the ecosystem entrepreneur is fundamental. From the ICT Secretariat, an internet work study group was created the last year to work on the most relevant internet points that have an impact on the economy. The topics we are currently working on are OTT, big data, and IoT. And these topics are very important for the entrepreneur ecosystem. In this framework, Argentina, there is a huge ecosystem of developer, hardware and software developer. Regarding IoT, we are working in two main points. We are doing research on different topics. We made an international benchmarking about IoT situation and the principal issues, like roaming, cybersecurity, regulatory policies. We do a public consultation to understand what are the major markets' needs. And when I'm talking about markets, it's very important the developers, the entrepreneur, and the small and medium enterprises. And the second, we are working a facilitator or promoter, where we create a working group working via the whole ecosystem and generate synergy among all the actors, where the entrepreneurs and developers can add their proposal with the small and medium enterprises, large enterprises, and telecommunication chambers. Here we, that is a very important action that we are doing, because we can do a link between the small, with the developers, with the large enterprises. Well, this is our current strategy, where we analyze the result this year to define a future strategy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I wish my Spanish was as good as your English, so I think we're good. Alberto?
Okay.
Okay. Well, thanks a lot for inviting me. Well, for the entrepreneurial ecosystem to flourish, traditionally you hear that the country needs to allow you to have an easy way to do business. And unfortunately, I think that historically, in the World Bank doing business rank that measures how easy it is to do business in each country, we didn't rank very well. But in spite of that, I think that has been a good thing for us, because we have learned to do things in spite of all these problems that maybe our countries have, in spite of maybe not having such a great infrastructure or having a tax program that it's not so easy for new startups to grow. In spite of that, I think Argentina has managed to create four of the five of the six unicorns that appear in Latin America. So most of the unicorns, the companies that are valuing more than $1 billion, came from Argentina. So I think that's a great thing, and that we have the training to do things in spite of the problems that might happen. At the same time, I must recognize that in the last years we have made a lot of advances. We have a very important entrepreneurial community. There's an association of entrepreneurs that has pushed a lot for an entrepreneurial law that has been passed in the last months. And that is a very important step for this entrepreneurial ecosystem, because it has changed a lot of fundamental things. One thing that was a problem here was that to start to create a new company, the bureaucratic thing lasted maybe a couple of months. Now with this new law, you can create a company in one day. So that's a really big step forward. The other thing also is this law creates a lot of seed funds and generates a public mixed public and private sector funds to be able to put money in these new startups, and it even grants zero interest rate funds for small startups. So those kind of things, I think they're quite interesting. From the Chamber of Software, the CESI that I'm representing here, we are also working a lot towards fostering these entrepreneurial efforts. Of course, we have some different initiatives. We have initiatives for the local market, and we are also trying to make our companies grow bigger and stronger, and we are trying to make them internationalize. We have created a network, Argentina Network, abroad, that has created offices in different countries. Initially in America, we have an office in the US, in Mexico, in Colombia, in Chile, that works as a first step towards internationalization, where we have a lot of studies to help companies that want to go abroad understand the tax regime in this destination, to understand which is the market, and to help make this big step of internationalization. So those kind of things are interesting. Another interesting thing that I think we have here in Argentina is that there is a law that generates a lot of incentives for the software industry, but it's not free. It really thinks about how to make this industry bigger. So it asks you as a company to really show that you are investing in R&D and that you have a quality certification. So those are things that ensure that in the long term, the industry is going to grow. We have this law in place. We hope this law will be continuing. It ends in 2 or 3 years, but I think that's been a very good step to make this ecosystem of software industry grow.
Thank you very much. It's very inspiring, and see how can public and private sector collaborate. And I was impressed by the numbers that you just gave us. Maybe it should be an inspiration for other people to come to Argentina and start their business as well. But I hope we can do it elsewhere. I think it's safe to say that the innovation divide is growing, and it's growing faster. ITU has shown us that in the previous studies that they have delivered. But I also that Ms. Nibal can also add something regarding this increased need of resources in order to reduce this gap and as well to empower the ecosystem of innovation in several countries. Ms. Hilda, can you add something, please?
Yes, in fact, unfortunately, the gap between developed and developing countries is huge in innovation, and we can see it very clearly in some statistics. And sometimes, at ESCOA, we made some study, in fact, about landscape of innovation in the Arab region. This is one of example, and I can distribute some copy of the flyer, which shows, in fact, that when we compare the innovation indexes and take into consideration the GDP, the figure change completely. And in the Arab country, for example, we saw that some middle countries like Morocco, middle countries in terms of income, like Morocco, Lebanon, or Jordan, they are doing even better than rich country like UAE, KSA, or Kuwait, or something like that, or the other Gulf countries. Then it is really important to look at the indexes and to evaluate how we are standing, globally, and taking into account the resources that we have, because we don't have the same resources in all countries. And for that reason, to seek other resources, I believe today with the SDG, there are many ways where we can have fund. There is fund from international organization, from advanced country, from developed country. But I would like to mention that sometimes the funds, it is targeting specific topics. For example, climate change, then we have to address carefully the fund that are available and where and what which theme they are targeting. In fact, is it for climate change, or is it job creation, or is it, for example, water resources and so on? And we know that with the SDG today, there are a lot of theme which are, and there are a lot of global issue that has importance at the global level. Then here there is this fund from this one. There is the funding from developed country. There is fund from. I would like to mention for job creation nowadays, there is fund from crowdfunding. Crowdfunding is booming in a way in many countries, you have a lot of potential, especially for young innovator. And then here for great idea, you can find some fund even using crowdfunding. We have a platform in the Arab region, it's called Zumal, and it's really booming, in fact, and we are astonished by the result. There is fund sometimes, the banks, of course, the banks and with the venture capital. Venture capital are very important, and in some countries where we don't have venture capital, we have realized that there is lack of innovation. The venture capital existence, it has a lot of effects on the innovation and in the creation of startup. This is some idea that I share, but I believe other panelists have other ideas.
Thank you very much. Mr. Bach, would you like to add something regarding the ITU perspective?
Thank you, Felipe. Thank you to our panelists for enlightening us. ITU has been really running some innovation research in several countries, and what we find is that there is a growing digital innovation divide. It's not about a digital divide. The digital divide is actually growing. If you look at all indicators, the statistic on ICT, if you look at the statistic from WIPO on the Global Innovation Index, you will see that developing countries are actually struggling more and more. And this is despite all of the awareness we had around the technology and the use of technology. I think we believe what's happening is that people are substituting technology for change, and technology is not basically a root cause of change. Technology is not the change, technology is an enabler. So when we look at Argentina has four unicorns. Well, every country, I think, today aspires to be like Silicon Valley. But what you realize is when you start looking at the ecosystem of Silicon Valley, by the way, Silicon Valley is not a country. It's actually, you know what I'm saying. It's a town. It's actually several towns cobbled together, right? So it's not even about countries' ecosystem anymore. It's about ecosystem around cities, around the different areas. And when we talk about sustainability, if we want to close the digital divide, we have to look at the innovation divide. And the innovation divide will only happen if we look at the stakeholders in an ecosystem and we understand what their requirements are. So what we have done over the past 2 years is we have looked at 5 to 6 countries and we have helped them develop very specific digital strategies which will help them. I don't have any presentation for you, but I'll distribute it. This is an example of Rwanda, and they can tell us a little more about what we did with them. With the country. But what you're looking at is some of the things that Mr. Patron was mentioning and also Nibal in terms of what is important in a country. You have infrastructure, you have access to resources, so they're key ingredients. But that's not the only thing. Despite being able to solve the problem in an environment, you need to understand what the stakeholders in that environment are doing. And when you start looking at this, this is what the country will be looking like. It's when you color code a country. So this is the example of Rwanda, and to tell you anything that is red is not good, anything that's yellow is not good. So you have 35 ingredients here. If any of these is not really good, then you are not going to be able to have a really good digital ecosystem. And in the case of Rwanda, I remember when I went with the Honorable Minister, he says, Mo, I want to have a $5 billion economy. Well, never mind, the economy of Rwanda today is $5 billion. In ICT, meaning ICT-enabled economy. And I say, well, how do we do this? How do we strengthen our ICT private sector? How do we make sure that the whole country gets to do this? And my answer was, well, you can do this, but you need to understand that there is a lot of things that needs to happen. It's not just about access to venture capital fund. It's not just about crowdfunding, right? We know that there are new mechanisms to provide all these ingredients today. We have crowdfunding, we have crowd equity. In fact, crowd equity has to part venture capital fund. So we have all the time new mechanisms and new ways where we're getting countries to actually innovate on the ways they access resource. So, but what we know is important is that we need to look at the ecosystem holistically. We need to look at the actions of all stakeholders in that ecosystem. And we have seen an example of Argentina where we have the private sector who is doing a lot on market access, who is doing a lot on talent development, who is doing a lot on developing the innovation spaces. So at the end of the day, I think it's very important that we do not get too attached to technology. Let's just try to understand what problem we want to solve in a country. And those are very simple. We want to make sure people have jobs. And to do this, people need to create product and services, as Ms. Nibal explained. This is what innovation is. And to do this, ICT help you create all kind of different type of product and services. Not only that, but to actually place them anywhere in the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. This just led me to my next question, because we're talking about challenges and there's a lot of different perspectives in order to tackle the different challenges and the challenges that, majorly the challenge that the public sector has to overcome. And this direct me to Dr. Shah. In Pakistan, what are the challenges that you've been facing and what are the stakeholders doing about those challenges? And some of them have been already mentioned by the previous speakers, but can you share with us your experience? Thank you.
Sure, thank you very much. Firstly, let me just make a general comment. If you look at the overall innovation that has happened in the first decade of this century, you would see that it happened mainly because there were no regulations. Their technology was available. You had good academic institutions who were promoting entrepreneurship. And even the society in general had a mindset where failure was tolerated, and you even had high school dropouts who came up with ideas, who were successful businessmen, and they established world-class companies. So this was a general society that was actually society as well as availability of the technology, academic institutions, and the involvement of the government, which was actually reduced involvement of the government in those cases. But this is not the case, and that's why you see the difference in between developed and developing countries. The challenges that we face now, coming to your question, one of the major challenges that in general governments are just for conformity. You have rules, you have regulation, you just need to follow that. Even as a regulator, whenever I talk about innovations, they say, why do you have to innovate? Your job is just to regulate and that's it. But slowly and gradually, this thing is being realized that we need to be more innovative. And we have taken some steps. The government as a whole has actually taken some steps, and that's actually the most important part, that the government as a whole at the top level must realize the importance of innovation, importance of ICTs, and they need to take steps so that all the other fall in line. So for example, innovation digital in citizen services, one of the things that has happened is that the government has created certain boards, software export board, IT board, who are coming up with solutions for citizens. For example, there is a solution for making sure that immunization actually happens. The health worker actually go to each and every village and they do the immunization, and that is done through an app that is geotagged. So the person has to go there and click from there that actually, and take the picture of the child also, that he or she has actually immunized that child. Similarly, improving the attendance in school, similarly helping the farmers. So these are the IT boards in different provinces who are actually now working on citizen services. So that's one part of it. And then you have the entrepreneurial culture, innovation culture. For that, I believe, and this has my experience in the government is like around 5.5 years, is that government in general, it's a little difficult for the government to execute things. So that's why for general innovation, for helping the entrepreneurs, the government has gone for public-private partnerships. And they award the project to a private sector, and then the private sector actually executes that. And one of the example of that has been very successful, and actually I was involved in that because I sit on the board of that company, government plus private sector owned company, which was the establishment of the National Incubation Center, which was actually inaugurated by the Secretary General ITU himself. And that has been a very good story as far, and it was actually done through the private sector. One of the biggest telecom operators is partnering with the government in executing that. And so far the results have been very good. There were 5 companies who went to 4YFN in Barcelona 4 years from now. They made it to the first 10. Similarly, recently we had a hackathon around SDGs, and that the winner of that was then invited by ITU to Busan. They won there also. And then now they are moving into the next stage. Of course, I have seen the report, and now they are in that valley of death phase, because it has only been 1.5, 2 years. And now what they need is that they need some funding for their ideas. For that, the government has some grants. And now the private sector also has actually come in. Even the companies like pharmaceutical companies are also coming and looking at different ideas that they are in. Many of them are actually working on local problems. So that's another thing which is kind of a little different from, you know, general innovations, like, for example, when we talk about Facebook and Google, it's probably not, they're not solving a local problem, but these startups and companies are actually solving local problems. And some of them, for example, are related to women empowerment, making health facilities available in the rural areas of Pakistan. And one important area that we have worked, I would not say a lot, but we have made significant progress, is on work in the for the persons with disabilities. Finally, my suggestion to all of you, and I think it's a suggestion from ITU also, is that yes, of course, we have to provide connectivity, and by connectivity we should mean broadband, not just basic voice connectivity. That is a priority, but that's not the whole thing. We have to move to overall digitization, and finally the innovation policy. So that's actually what we need to move on towards. And again, I would reemphasize that this has to come from the top. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Very interesting views there. I retain two of them. For me, they are crucial. One, it's to give the public the experience of using ICT, which is very interesting, because normally we tend to impose things as better for people. They don't understand it. They have to experience that. And so making the public using apps and using technology may empower more their will to innovate as well. And the other thing I retained was the to solve the local problems. I mean, we intend to bring the next big idea from the outside, and sometimes we forget that locally we have problems that we have to tackle. We're doing that in Mozambique, for instance, and I see here the Director General of the regulator from Mozambique. We're doing that kind of work in Mozambique, trying to tackle the local problems, because if people can see that technology can solve their problems locally, it will probably empower them more to focus on new ideas, on new solutions, on a new approach. But I think you want to add something on the policy side?
Yeah. Thank you. I just wanted to actually address your statement about policy, moving beyond broadband policies. And I think this is exactly what we're trying to do today, because we know that the digital economy is actually about empowering ICT through all segments and sectors of the economy. And to do this at ITU, we have been pushing a lot of broadband policy, ICT policies, whatever you call it, Vision 2010, 2020. Now what we're starting to see more and more is the Vision 2030s and beyond are looking more into actually adopting innovation or updating their ICT policies with innovation and entrepreneurship policies. And the reason why many countries are looking to do this is because they understand that we're actually not going to be able to connect the next 1.5 billion, which is one of the targets of the Connect, which is to connect the 1.5 billion people in the next, I think it's 2025. Well, it's not going to happen because the problem is services, and services are lacking. For people to have services, they need to solve local problems. And for them to solve local problems, they need to have local innovation capacity. So if we do not go and update all of the policies to make sure that they include innovation and entrepreneurship policies or policy fostering digital innovation and digital entrepreneurship, the last mile will never be closed. And we see this in many, many places. We see regulators who are going in and putting in all kind of incentive to the market, but the market is not responding. So from our point of view, this is why we're actually doing what we're doing. We're really pushing for ICT policies to be updated in general with innovation and entrepreneurship policies, so we can have this culture of entrepreneurship both in the private sector as well as the public sector. And there are very good example of this in both cases. In the public sector, for example, for those, anybody from Bangladesh here? No. Okay, so in Bangladesh, my friends from Bangladesh have an innovation, over 1,000 people innovation team in the government. And this was driven from an initiative from the Prime Minister's office, where they're actually training civil servants to actually create new services. It's no longer just digitalizing. It's actually going beyond. It's teaching civil servants how to create new processes, how to transform them. And they're doing some of the same things that you're doing in Pakistan, which is providing funds, working with public-private partnerships. So they're really going beyond what the normal government should be doing. But this also has to happen in the private sector. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. I think it's... Do you want to have something?
I may. I mean, there is an aspect, I mean, that we haven't tackled. I believe it is very important for some countries, especially developing countries, which is related to education. Education at early stage, in fact, in some countries there is, we have this style of memorization, style of education, and this is really not very helping. In fact, we need to have more, to open the critical, to make more critical thinking for young people, our young people, even even at early stage of education, and also critical thinking, I mean curiosity and so on. And also the culture, maybe Mohammed mentioned the culture. The culture of innovation, it is also very important in a society to have, I mean, a young entrepreneur and to encourage them to go and go to the market. This is important because sometimes in many countries, it is more, once you have a failure in your experience, you are not very well seen in the society. And this culture of failure, that even if we fail one time, we can have success later on. This is the risk-taking aspect. It is not very common in most developing countries. And this is something that we have to push, in fact, and I believe it is important to mention because we haven't mentioned it.
Very much. We have touched here some practical cases. I'll move then to some real cases. We've been talking about some of the theoretical approach, but now we have two practical cases here from Rwanda and from Moldova. I'll start maybe with Rwanda because we have addressed that already, and then I'll go to you, Sergio. Okay, please, sir.
Thank you. James Musinguzi, I'm from the regulator. I work in the innovation department. Yeah, so some of the challenges have already been discussed, and I think I don't have to go back to this, but when you have challenges, you could look at them as challenges or opportunities. So in the discussions we're having, for us we felt these are better handled when you collaborate. You don't have to start reinventing the wheel in ICT. So some of the big things we're doing in Rwanda is collaborating at the African level in what we call Smart Africa. Smart Africa basically brings together countries who have the same agenda to exploit IT in speeding up our development process. So what Smart Cities is doing is giving the heads of states the power, the exposure to set targets which are going to impact the social society. In one of our projects in Rwanda, where broadband is being exploited, is where we're trying to extend government services online. He talked about the issues we have with entrepreneurs. We're trying to see how to empower the entrepreneurs to work with government, because in government, down there is the biggest employer. So if government doesn't employ private sector, we don't have a very good result. So innovators, government, together trying to exploit IT to facilitate the civil society. In exploiting this is giving services to the citizen. One of the biggest challenges in governments today is how to extend their offices to the local sector, where is what we're trying to exploit innovation. Or maybe the financial services. But I would let Moldova also say something here.
Sure. Thank you very much. Good morning to all. First of all, I would like to express our gratitude to the ITU's willingness and to unleash its resources and intellectual capacity of the innovation service of the BDT to provide Moldova with the ICT-centric innovation country review, which was conducted and has to be published very soon. So this still emphasizes the IT's support towards my country's commitment to empower an innovation-driven economy. So it recognizes the importance of innovation in driving a strong and strategic ICT sector and in accelerating economic development of my country. Moldova identifies itself among the countries with a strong focus on enhancing and growth of the IT industry, as well as expanding its potential. This vector is highlighted by successful implementation of strategic documents such as National Strategy for Information Society Development, Digital Moldova 2020, and by the Strategy for IT Industry Competitiveness and Growth. So Moldova has almost fully leveraged this potential of two strategies, and these new insights from the ITU are really timely to further provide our country with new opportunities to develop its ICT-centric innovation ecosystem. So this brings us to crucial importance of the new joint work just performed during the 6 months and meant to accelerate the transformation by capitalizing on the advantages that ecosystem has and by creating a common vision on how reforms can meet the needs of various stakeholders. In fact, the country review provides a snapshot of challenges and opportunities currently faced by stakeholders in my country, and they are complemented by 7 key recommendations based on the needs analysis. And these specific policies, programs, and flagship projects recommendations will serve as a reference tool for us to help guide and support innovation with the aim to make Moldova attractive as a potential hub for emerging technologies. And by the way, these new approaches to policy making became the basis for a new strategy for fostering the digital innovation ecosystem that is currently developed in my country. Thank you.
Thank you. But what is this new approach that we're looking at?
Well, what Sergio was just talking about is some of the work and how we approach this in the Republic of Moldova. And we have done this for Rwanda as well, so you can get some snapshot of that. The one for Rwanda, for Moldova is not yet public. But what the ITU has done lately is we have launched a toolkit on actually how countries can do this. It's actually nice if ITU comes in and help you do this in countries. But what we believe in is really empowering the countries to do this themselves. So if you look at the example of Moldova, we went in there, they had this vision 2020, which actually needs to be updated on new pillars based on entrepreneurship and innovation, like our the chairman from PTA was just mentioning. So we help Moldova improve their strategies and adopt this or make specific recommendations towards adopting a new digital economy strategy. And in there, one of the approaches we use is a bottom-up where all the stakeholders are coming together. And we went a little further because what we started doing is actually teaching people creativity methodologies. And why creativity methodologies in policy? Because we believe policy needs to take a new approach, which is a policy experimentation approach. So all of the methodologies you can find here is a toolkit that we call the Bridging the Digital Innovation Divide. And you also have a couple of case studies that you will see in here. And if anybody is interested, I can discuss offline with this.
Thank you, Bob. So as you can see, as we can see as well, there is different perspectives and different challenges, frameworks, they vary from country to country. So what comes up to my mind is it possible to have just one view? Is it possible to have a unique approach that can help us to foster good digital innovation frameworks? Is that possible? And I would like to address this to Mr. Yushi and to any other of the other panelists that want to comment. Can we have a common view to have a common framework?
Thank you very much. Well, I'd like to share some experience as one of my previous role was sort of a facilitator development of technology developing fund facilitator something in National Institute of ICT, and based on my experience, I would wish to highlight 3 points. One is, the important role of government. Government leadership, maybe in terms of vision or a specific action plan, that is critical. Although the funding is seed money, private sector and academia put together and implement those projects as a facilitator or a leader on this aspect. So leadership of government is important, although the funding is very seed function. And second thing, as I mentioned, many speakers mentioned, public, private, and academia partnership. That is very critical. Government itself cannot develop any technology in the laboratory and academia or in industry. That is the place we have technology and innovation. And thirdly, I wish to highlight the international cooperation. Today's event is one of the
venue for sharing experience. ITU has been leading this area. Today, area representative Yaroslav Ponda is here, and of course, my colleague Mohammed is leading this innovation area. We are trying to share the experience of countries among the region, that is regionally or inter-regionally. I joined the event in Europe and the CIS event, and was enthusiastic. We try to expand this experience regionally and inter-regionally, and depending on the needs of the, we wish to respond to the needs. And in terms of implementation, after vision, we need some clear action plan and a regular monitoring mechanism with some clear indicators. That is based on my suggestion. Thank you.
Very much. Any other further comments? No? So I'll jump just to the next question. Yes, please.
Just about common framework, I believe the most important ingredient are known now, like the ecosystem and legal and regulatory framework. However, sometimes we have, according to the level of development of country or region, we might suggest something else. We might have a combination. What are the priority for at a certain level, according to the level of innovation in some countries, what is the priority for boosting innovation? For example, at ESQA, we proposed a kind of a framework for to promote innovation in the Arab countries. And here we gave the priority based on the level of innovation in this country. We gave priority to some area. For example, education is very important. I just mentioned research and development. We realized that member countries in the Arab region, they don't spend too much on research and development. The percentage of R&D from the GDP, it is less than 1%, while globally it is 3 to 5%, on the research and development. For that reason, we pushed them in our policy framework to focus on R&D and to invest more in R&D. Also legal and regulatory framework, as well as supporting innovators. Then I believe sometimes the generality exists, but we have to focus and give a priority to the according to the level of development.
Thank you very much. Bob, you want to add something?
Yeah.
Just before that, this was supposed to end at 9 o'clock, but can we be innovative and overcome the 9 o'clock? Is it possible, Mr. Yoshi? Yes? Okay. So let's invite.
Thank you for that inspiration, Felipe. I just want to respond to these priority questions. I think Nivali is correct that the ingredients are known. The ingredients are typical infrastructure. We actually define them as six. You have infrastructure, whether it's broadband or it's soft infrastructure, knowledge centers, or some of those things. We have talent and access to talent, which is 21st century talents. What are people doing to get the next technological skills for their, let's say, for example, in data analytics in schools or creativity methodologies? We have resources, which is general, which is venture capital, seed funds. A lot of the times, those ingredients are meeting, especially at an early stage of entrepreneurship, where people really need something to make sure they develop their product and services. We have access to market, which is domestic market, as well as international market. We heard from our friend from Argentina what, for example, the Chamber is doing to actually foster international market access. This is super critical for an entrepreneur to have demand for its product and his product or her product and services. We have this sort of cultural thing which has to do with the activities and building the culture of entrepreneurship. And of course, all that has to be guided by a big vision of a country. In many countries, we still see that people are talking about we want an e-government strategy. E-government strategy is not an innovation strategy. An e-government strategy is just literally adopting digital tools to improve digital services. However, we're now having the discussion where countries are thinking bigger. I say, well, we want a digital economy strategy. Well, what does that mean? There's only one thing. A digital economy strategy is an innovation-driven strategy. Michael Porter has defined three sort of segments for every economy. He called them the factor-driven economy, efficiency-driven economy, or innovation-driven economy, or knowledge-driven. Now, every country has a piece of this, but if you look at the indicators, for example, from WEF, we can have many countries rank as one of these economies. So the idea is every country really needs to have one strategy, which is a strategy to migrate towards an innovation-driven economy. But by doing so, the stakeholders in that country have to make sure that they're not just focusing on the high end of the economy, they're actually pulling, they're solving the local problems. So they're not just trying to create the next Google or the next unicorn, right? It's actually not even about a unicorn. It's about what are these communities doing to solve their problems and what is government role in fostering this. So when I talk to a couple of governments, the priorities, you have to remember, governments are political. So if I'm in one country, one prime minister or one minister might say, well, my priority is to solve corruption. Okay, that is a real priority. And if we come up with any action that does not support that priority, because the normal citizens do not understand what innovation is. So we have to be able to sort of have all of these initiatives support one of the political priorities. So that's just one example. Corruption, transparency, government transformation, because everybody can sort of adopt and align to that. Another one we see is jobs. If our strategy is job creation. So at the end of the day, I think we have to be careful not to talk about priorities that the common people do not understand, because if we want the ecosystem to be vibrant, we have to have the support of everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. So as you can see, we're looking at this problem in different perspectives, different initiatives, different policies, different programs, projects, etc. But as far as I understand, there are two key elements here. I mean resources and commitment, correct? So to Dr. Shah and to Ms. Nibal again, what are you doing, or what you think should be done to secure resources and commitment to engage your ecosystems in terms of development initiatives?
When we talk about resources, I mean, we only think sometimes that it's only the funding that is required, which in many cases is not the situation. It's not the funding, it's the commitment of the government in general that they will have supporting policies. I think the biggest thing that the government can probably do is to actually, if I want to be too blunt, to get out of the way and let the progress happen and let the innovation happen. So I think the first thing would be to look very, very closely at what are the policies that are actually hindering all this innovation. For example, what is the procedure of getting a company registered? What about the tax issues related there? Are there any, would as soon as you register, would the tax authorities be after you? What about if you fail and you want to close a company down? Would they let you close it down? These kind of policies and many others for that matter. And then of course the issue of funding is important, but as far as the government is concerned, the most important part is the right policies. And of course in our case, for example, we are trying on that. I would not say that we have been able to remove all the impediments, but at least we are working towards that. And recently actually the thing that has happened is that the Prime Minister himself has actually formed a committee, and all the other ministers are member of that, all those who actually can have anything to do with ICT or commerce or trade. And he himself is an engineer, so he probably understand this also. So these are the things that need to be done. And then of course some funding and encouragement. There are many people who would work with the government, and there are many private companies who would be ready to bring in funding if they see the right policies. So I would say policies, I would stop there and let Nibal talk more about
that. Yeah, I mean, I agree with you 100%. Policy is very important, and I believe it is very important to have a vision at the country level. I mean, we have seen that in some country, they do have one or two or three policies, but I mean, there is no common vision. Why we are going to innovation, I mean? Then I believe to have a vision that is shared with different stakeholders, vision that mention why we are doing this innovation policy, in a way. Who will collaborate to implemented, and what are the means that we are proposing? The means legal, as well as financial, if there is any, I mean. Then I think it is specifying the objective of the government and to make it, to make awareness about this vision and to provide the means necessarily for implementing it is very important. Then vision should answer why, what, and with which means. This is very important, I think, at national level. And also, I believe in many cases, sometimes the government put the policy without interacting with other stakeholders. And I believe here the interaction with other stakeholders, either academia or private sector should be on board from the beginning. Formulation of the policy or the strategy. Then I believe also to get everybody involved from the beginning till the end, I mean, this is also very important. Important is the linkage between private and academia, which is sometimes lacking in many countries, especially here I'm speaking about developing countries. The linkage or the interaction or the collaboration between private sector and university or academia or research centers, this is also very important, and it is very important ingredient. But what else I would like to add is to follow up the implementation of the policy. I mean, because only having policy formulated, it is not enough. We have to have a mechanism for the follow-up or for the implementation and to see how it is taking place and evaluating progressively how this strategy is implemented in a way. Then we don't have to formulate and just stop here, but we have to implement and to have even organization, maybe dedicated organization for follow-up or for a kind of committee for follow-up of the implementation of this strategy. This is maybe my 2 cents.
What is clear for me is there's no unique approach, right? There's several problems, there are several challenges, there are several perspectives, although the two gentlemen from Argentina have been really quiet and they have success in their countries. So I will challenge you, can you enlighten us regarding your insights to achieve success in this innovative ecosystem?
Well, the people here in the panel have been talking about all that has to do with regulations and things that the government can do, and I think that's the basic ground, it's a must. I'm happy to see that, for example, here in Argentina, there's a lot of initiatives towards e-government and public government and all those things, but digital transformation is not that. Digital transformation is more to rethink, to use technology to rethink business. And in that sense, from the Chamber of Software, what we are trying to do is to spread the gospel about this idea and to try to involve all the society and all the economy, because I think it's everywhere it's more or less the same, but in Argentina, small and medium business are 90% of the companies. So the government and the big companies, of course, they have internal departments that can think about strategy and they can think about how to implement R&D and all that, but what about the small and medium businesses? How can we help them to understand this idea of digital transformation and how to rethink their businesses? I'm confident that this idea is permeating. I think that not a week goes by without a hackathon being made here, and not just government-sponsored hackathons or maybe from the big companies or the traditional technological companies. We had a hackathon from a beer company, so they also are understanding that they need to innovate. And from the chamber, what we are trying to do is to bring the different actors together. So we have specific events of digital transformation for the government, digital transformation for the industry, where we try to put together the technological companies, the software companies that are providing these new solutions, and also this small and medium business that would really make benefit of these ideas. And we try to foster this kind of relationship and conversations. That's a very big, important thing that I think it's one of our main focus right now, to spread this idea of digital transformation to all the actors in the economy. From the government, I think that one of, interesting idea that they are doing right now. It's they have this digital transformation for SMBs, where they give these SMBs loans to acquire software or hardware, and they're making a marketplace for, I don't know, you're an agricultural company, and well, you have a menu of which are the available tools and solutions that you could incorporate into your own business. So if I may say that, I think that's the main idea, to allow all the actors of the economy to get involved in this digital transformation idea, and not just the government or the large corporations.
Thank you, Alberto. Ricardo, do you want to add something? Please.
Well, I think that there is not one solution to define how will be the way to develop the innovation and the entrepreneur in a country. Every culture is very different in different way. In Argentina, the last year changed the government, so today we are changing the way we are making policies. So we are studying where will be our path for 5 and 10 years. That's the reason why today we are working in this way, like I said before. We are trying to doing tables where every actor from this seems express what they think, what they need, and where, for example, we are working with CESI too, and where the developers can talk with the big enterprises who have the resources too, and with another minister, not only with the Minister of Modernization. We are working with, for example, Minister of Transport, Health, and other ones. But, we think that we are in this way, and we are trying to define the best policies to improve the innovation in Argentina.
Thank you very much. I think it's pretty much clear as well that collaboration is one of the key words, and every one of you have addressed that already. Mr. Yushi also mentioned that on his previous intervention regarding international collaboration. And this is a question for all of you, I challenge Mr. Yushi to come first. Regarding international collaboration, are there any good practices that we can take from your experiences? And after Mr. Yushi, I would like also to understand the Moldova perspective, and any other countries in the panel or from the audience that would like to come in and comment on this. So international collaborations experiences.
Yes. Thank you very much. Yes, as I mentioned, ITUD has been working hard for sharing the knowledge and experience of many countries, starting with this in particular topic, Europe, and joined event in Europe and CIS. And I wish to highlight one more thing, the leadership of the government. In fact, I handed this country case study to Minister of Rwanda during the Minister of WISIS Forum. That is the leadership of minister. In fact, the minister was the chairman of our WISIS Forum. And also to Moldova, Moldova government is regularly hosting a regional development forum that is the yearly event of ITUD in a CIS region. And acting minister, also I handed this launch of a country case study to acting minister Taref. And that is the leadership of government. So we used to highlight the mixture of regional and inter-regional cooperation based on ITUD regional initiative. And also this WTDC is deciding the future of ITU, ICT, future of ICT. And definitely innovation is one of the key area that is a cross-cutting issue. It includes various aspects, 5G, IoT, AI, many technology could be developed, nurtured by funding or facilitation by government and partnership, public, private, academia partnership. And also I wish to highlight the success in Argentina. We shared the success yesterday in Argentina. Yes, we learned that government is helping the participation of academia to ITU. And that is a leadership of government. So I wish to highlight again. Thank you.
Sergio, do you want to add something, please?
Yes, so Mr. Dragoy already mentioned the IDU Regional Development Forum. I'm glad that this year we had it for two regions, CIS and Europe, and we hosted participants from 12 countries, such as Netherlands, Georgia, Portugal, Romania, Ukraine, and other countries. And another event I would like to mention, the Moldova ICT Summit. It's the main ICT event we host every year. And this year it was focused on developing the competitiveness of the ICT sector and promoting IT entrepreneurship and proliferating innovation. So this event gathered over 600 participants. We had speakers from 23 countries at the event. So, thank you.
Very good, Serge. Any other comment from the panelists regarding the international collaboration?
I think I just mentioned very briefly, but there is one project that I will believe we need lots of collaboration. It is national as well as international. And that is innovative solutions using ICTs for persons with disabilities. And we have done some work. We can share that I'll share it with Mr. Ba. But we need, I think, more collaboration on that because it's a worldwide problem. And we need, in fact, we have one of our participants from Pakistan is a person with disability. He has visual impairment. He cannot see anything, but he is here and he is contributing.
In fact, I would say that also in project is very important, and I know now there is a kind of capacity building project for innovation. I mean, it is running nowadays under the umbrella of the UN agencies, I mean, and it is collaborative project where it is targeting capacity building in developing countries, especially in developing countries, on innovation and the policy innovation and so on. This is very good aspect, but I would like to mention another aspect where we have international collaboration are very important, and which is open science. I mean, if there is a kind of collaboration between international community on open science, open knowledge, and open innovation, it will really be very helpful for all people. I mean, for all countries and for all citizens. I mean.
Thank you. We are 15 minutes ahead from the time that was scheduled for us. But before, I'm going to ask all of you three key takeaways from this session. But before that, I would like to open the floor to the audience, and I see one hand already. Please, sir, can you identify yourself and put your question forward?
Thank you. I've been patient with you for this occasion. My name is Engineer Charles Chike Asado, Nigeria. Just moved from the ministry to the university, and I'm in the University Innovation Center. One thing that struck me, I'm just seeking for clarification, please. I'm not just adding. One thing that struck me when I came in that you said we have gone beyond broadband. We have gone beyond broadband, and I feel broadband is the basis. Particularly to the BTT, do you have statistics of, I'm talking now of Africa, because most of you are very developed, broadband is not your problem. apology to Rwanda, because I know Rwanda is ahead in Africa. But many countries in Africa, accessibility is the problem. I want to know whether BDT has a modality or a system, or do they have a projection to analyze these broadband issues in developing countries, some of the countries that have reached and some of the countries that have gone beyond that, and some of the countries who don't even understand anything about broadband. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I quickly highlight. Yes, we have a broad range of projects. One project is a private sector funded broadband project, a specific project in West Africa. We have 9 countries piloting. Each country starting with a base station of a 4G network to pilot the feasibility of broadband network. Another area, we have a study group question on rural communication that will summarize some report that is suitable for broadband or some rural communication infrastructure. They summarize the report regularly. I think the study group too submitted report to this WTDC. So these are the key area. Of course, we have various projects, maybe Mohammed or some colleague may add, but the two key issues, pilot project and study group question.
Yeah, I just want to add to that. I think we need to move away from the notion that we're going to push broadband everywhere, because the problem is we cannot push broadband because the services aren't there. The business models are not even sustainable, and the people do not even know what you're giving them. So from that point of view, is from my perspective as the head of innovation, I would like to shift the discussion to more of an innovation capacity. Now, when we talk about infrastructure, there's two components. There's a broadband component, and the infrastructure, hard infrastructure, this will be broadband. There is also the soft infrastructure. This is the innovation capacity. Together, they will allow countries to actually have very specific program. When we did a report for Rwanda and actually Kenya, one of the key things is this is what you see. Last mile will not be closed if you don't start building this innovation capacity in the various areas, because this is what will help the demand and also the supply match, right? So from that point of view, I think we need to reframe the question from being purely broadband to more of an innovation capacity that can help us close the gap. And this is where we come in from with the new angle. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I just remember that yesterday we talked about that also in the academia initiative, where I presented the idea that we're developing in the Portuguese-speaking countries using deployment of access to internet, but at the same time working together in order to not allow that this digital innovation divide grow, because it's not only about the access, it's about what you can do with the access, and that's a very key important thing that Bo has addressed. Everyone, we know each other, but please can you?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm Anand Raj Khanal from Nepal. I want to share two experiences from the developing world. When you talk about innovation, the people at the government think that it is innovation is all about technology. But they never think of business process re-engineering that the government has to do. Second point, we are talking about the involvement of academia. We are talking about the research and development, which normally it is the part of academia does. There is a clear disconnect between the government, industry, and academia in our part of the world. They don't talk to each other. The industry and the academia doesn't know what is national policies, what is national strategy of, for example, we are talking about SDGs. And if you go to any university, they don't know what is SDG and how their innovations, how their research and development is going to help achieve those SDG targets. So I think ITU is quite involved with academia and the industry, and as well as the government. So this disconnect has to be breathed somewhere, that innovation is not about technology alone. It's about process, it's about service. And if these three components, who innovate, do research and development, it's for achieving the development goals. If they are disconnected, how can you think that a country can prosper? I think this is one of the key problems of a developing world. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Very interesting perspective. Mr. Baez already addressed that as well during the previous intervention. I think you want to complement.
Yeah, I can see offline, but this always is a surprise for people, this when you look at this, because academia is one of the line. Actually, the first thing, you're right, people think that technology is the root cause of change. And I always say technology is not the root cause of change. It's an enabler to do something. In this case, government most jobs. Earlier we discussed about priorities. You really have to follow the government priorities, because that's the only thing people understand. They understand about corruption, they understand about jobs, they understand about this. So if you talk the language of innovation, do not talk about those real innovations. Talk about what it will do for people. So when we do these studies, the first time I did this in a country, and actually say, and the stakeholders, so the role, so you understand, is every stakeholder. Academia is one. Like CC will be on the support side. Government is one side. Then they look at this and say, well, this is 35 boxes, and some of these are color red, and who colored us red? And I say, well, I did not color you red. So basically what we do is we put all of these stakeholders you talk about in the room. So the process we use, there's always the surprise. Say, wait, why did you color me red? No, I did not color you red. This guy colored you red. And then they suddenly realize that they need to talk to each other because they do not understand which language each other are basically saying about each other. But it's really, this is the new policy approach that we're pushing forward. It's a policy experimentation approach where people are basically doing bottom-up policy making. And we don't do these policies. We just put them together, we give them the tools and say, guys, let's talk about real stuff now. And then at the end of the day, suddenly what happens is that the stakeholders themselves are creating the actions that they need to change their ecosystem, therefore to transform their digital economy. Thank you.
Whoa. Let's start from the end. Come on.
Yes, what you mentioned about academia and the rest of the
Sorry, can I just add something?
Yes.
In order to start to wrapping up, I was going to ask you, all of you, to give us at least three key takeaways, but I'll just ask for one sentence, one key takeaway. After your intervention, okay. If you can close with one key takeaway, I would appreciate it. Thank you.
Thanks. What you mentioned about academia being apart from the rest, I think it's quite true, and I don't know if it's everywhere, but for example, here in Argentina, I think that academia was like pure science, and if they went with to work with the private company, it was like they were going to the dark side, you know? And from the Chamber of Software, what we are trying to do is to talk a lot with them and to try to tell them what we are needing from the private sector, because if not, they did have these master plans, educational plans, that did not match our needs. And we are working a lot towards making these new kind of plans. And it's particularly important in our area and in our country, because this year, I think that our sector, the software sector, needed 15,000 new people, but the academia, the academia just put in place 9,000. So there's a big gap between our need and what they are providing. But at the same time, we have almost 10% of unemployment. So how this can be? It's kind of madness. I think that the government is addressing that has been one of our major complaints. And what do we need? They would ask, we need more people. And they had put in place the 111 plan. They call it 111,000 people that they want to train in ICT, so that we, the private sector, has more hands to innovate, because we were talking about broadband. Okay, you need broadband, but you also need people to help you innovate. And I think this has not been talked, but there's a real lack of people in this industry, and to try to teach and to foster this idea of technical skills in young people, it's very important, and we are doing that in all the stages of education.
And what about the key element to take away?
The key, I think it's what I mentioned before, to really try to understand that innovation is not just for one actor of the society, but for all the actors.
Dr. Shah?
Okay. I'll first reinforce what Mr. Mohammed said. Regarding broadband, by no means we have achieved connectivity. There are still areas which we don't have broadband. But from experience, what we have learned is that even those areas where there is no broadband, you provide broadband. Initially, you get those users who are kind of tech-savvy or they like it, and then the rest don't go for it. They need to be brought in through innovative application, otherwise they won't come. So it's not that broadband is not important. Broadband is just one component of the whole innovation process. So it's not to negate that. We need to continue with that, but consider it as a part, not a goal in itself. The second, I'll just comment on my colleague from Nepal. Actually, I have been in academia. Now, let's say if I give you the target, let's say your main job that I will judge you on is that the time that you come in, let's say at 8 a.m., the time that you leave, that you have to be at 8 and you have to leave at 4, that's the main criteria, and you have to keep your weight below 70 kg, let's say. So what will you do the whole day? You will try to meet these targets. So for academia, a professor, the target is publications, research grants. So that's why when we talked about that, we need a policy from the top level. That also means an educational policy, that you have professors who actually work on practical problems, not just on research publication that can contribute to the research body and maybe will be used after 20 years in some developing country, but there are real problems in your own. That's what we need to change also. So there has to be a change everywhere. Now about the key points, I have written three. Maybe I'll just quickly mention them. Innovation policy, of course, but beside that, we need to have an action plan with clear demonstration, clear clarity on who is responsible for what. And finally, collaboration and sharing, and I believe your office can take that lead. All of us can provide you with information that the projects that we are doing, you can put maybe a few lines and a link to that. And finally, whatever happens is done by people. So you need to develop your human resource who are trained in that, as Dr. Adlibi talked about. They should not be afraid of failure. People who take risk, who have this entrepreneurial, you know, risk-taking capabilities.
Okay, just a comment. I agree with 100% for my colleague in Nepal. I mean, research and development in some cases in the developing countries are not targeting local development, and this is really a problem for innovation, local innovation. Now we have a very good opportunity because we have the SDG. The SDG now, all countries normally are committed to SDG, and there is a commitment from high level, I mean, in the country. Then therefore, maybe there is an occasion to push all academia also and the research center to work on the developmental issue targeting SDG, water, energy, whatever. We have a lot of issues in SDG, and like that we have double, we can gain double in SDG as well as in innovation. My takeaway, I mean, I will change a little bit from what has been said. I will speak about openness. I believe openness is very important. Open data, open innovation, open research, open knowledge. It is very crucial, in fact, for innovation. Maybe you haven't tackled this issue very much in the discussion, but I believe it is very important to mention that openness is really very a driver for innovation in many countries.
Thank you. Ricardo.
Well, I didn't say before, but in our work, we are working with the academia too, because they have a lot of development and study, but they are inconnex. We are trying to do synergy between this work and with the private sector. I think that the key for this panel is fundamental, a cooperation between the public and private sector, academic and social, civil society too. With a public strategy very clear, and thinking the way how the student are teaching today. I think that is fundamental change the point of view in this end.
Thank you, Mr. Yushi.
I wish to reiterate the importance of international and regional cooperation. And I wish to highlight, we have a regular meeting. I wish to thank Argentina government for hosting a huge WTDC in a beautiful city of Buenos Aires. And also we are holding a regular regional development forum in each region and various meeting and fora. We organize telecommunication development advisory group, TDAG, every year. Please come to us. We have a remote connection. So that is the call for us. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, I'm just going to say I think it's important to have a common vision in the country and a clear vision that's actually quite ambitious, right? You can't limit yourself to just e-government strategy. And in doing so, you need to have a clear way to deliver this. So therefore, you need a digital innovation framework where you can gauge the all stakeholders in taking concrete actions and making it happen. That's it.
Thank you. I think my key takeaway would be support for government and entrepreneurs to allow innovation to happen in specific areas of the developing country. The private sector is very small, so it's not so big. So there is need for support of the private sector, both in terms of policies, as you clearly said, which should allow, let's say, peer-to-peer transfers, which currently today are becoming bigger than the amount of money held in banks. So that is something very important. Regarding broadband, yes, when we speak about broadband in this room, we're talking about 100 megabits per second. But to the innovators, they can use way less than what we are calling broadband. So yes, we have not yet got there, but what we have, we can use it.
Yeah, thank you. So I would mention first strengthening innovation capabilities in the ICT-centric ecosystem. The second would be IT industry competitiveness growth. And the third, finding resources for the projects we already have. In our case, it's about $40 million.
Thank you very much. We passed away our time, half an hour, almost 40 minutes. And I think we could go on because this is a very challenging topic. It's a very interesting topic as well. And innovation is all about this. It's about collaboration. It's about talking to each other, having all stakeholders around the same table. I'll just try to give some key takeaways from my side as well. I think we came to the conclusion that we can accelerate digital economies by shaping ICT-centric innovation ecosystems. I also think that we need to have digital innovation frameworks to help shape and define stakeholders' actions and make the transformation concrete. There is a need to accelerate shaping innovation ecosystems, as it was shown by ITU and UNESCO. There are good experiences already among ITU and the projects they have supported. I think we need to share that more frequently, and we have to put that out of the door of ITU and show the other countries what you've been doing. Resources and leadership are critical, as we saw, and resources here is not only about money. It's open, it's more than money. And collaboration, of course. I think this was also the key word. Actually, on the last GSR, one of the key words was collaboration as well, and I think we should never forget that, and taking collaboration as well on board, the fact of open, it's needed to improve. My last comment before I ask you if you have any other thing to add, it's not a comment, it's a proposal, it's a challenge for the ITU. I think it's clear that this is a very important and key area to the future of our world, in fact. So, and I think from the small talk that we have here, that we had here today, it's clear that we need to enlarge this discussion. So my challenge to the ITU is to make it bigger. Think how can we have a larger event to talk about innovation, and especially to tackle this problem of the digital innovation divide, which we cannot allow to happen, because otherwise we'll be jeopardizing millions and millions of life and opportunities. So if there are no more comments, if there's no more intervenings, I'll just close, and thank you all of you participating. Thank you for all of you to being here so early, and thank you to Moldova and Rwanda for sharing the experience, and of course thank you to the ITU for having this side event, which I think is very important. Thank you all.
For those who want a copy of the Rwanda report or the toolkit for bridging the digital innovation divide, please come forward and get one.